tell you the story behind the smartest bank in bot in Italy. The bot was made to support UbiBanca's integration of three other banks. And out of the project, there was a great user engagement. And there were many lessons learned that are now the foundation to do new and more ambitious projects. My name is Alessandro Vitale. I'm the founder of two artificial intelligence startups. The new one is called Conversate, and it's with proprietary artificial intelligence technologies for chatbots. And among other things, I'm also a member of the task force on artificial intelligence of the Italian government.
Good evening. My name is Matteo Baido. I'm head of IT innovation in UbiBanca. So 2017 has been a very busy year for UbiBanca. We completed the acquisition of three smaller banks. One is the notorious Banca Etruria, Banca Marche, and the smaller Cari Chieti. During the year, the organization has been working a lot on the project of integrating the banks and migrating the information systems of the banks. Actually, we completed the migration in October for the first bank, November for the second, and the next February for Cari Chieti, which is the smallest. In this beginning of the same year, my team and I has started getting into artificial intelligence. So we wanted to understand the technology, the solutions, and the possible use cases. At the end, we decided to put the two subjects together. Migration and artificial intelligence. So we came up with this, I think, brilliant idea of developing as a first use case a chatbot to support the employees of the acquired banks during the process of the integration of the merger. So we started working on Mario. Mario is an acronym for Migration Artificial Intelligence Operator. The project started with a big challenge. We have really little time, only 2 months, because in the middle of September we had the first test of migration for the first bank, so we needed to be live at the first days of September. We actually ended the vendor selection in May and June, and we met Conversate and Alessandro and his team only in June, so we decided to work with Conversate, among other 20 vendors. And we kicked off in June the 5th. So in only 2 months, we were able to develop, design, and integrate the bot. So the 5th of July, the second part of the project started, where we actually went in production, and we switched from 10, 15 test users to hundreds of test users. Hundreds of questions, and this was a big gap. It was surprising for me, at least, the difference between working with a test environment with only 10 people, or just we were trying to put questions to the bot, and the difference with hundreds of users was really a different, really a big gap. And this was one of the successes of the product, being able to work with hundreds of users, so to leverage on the machine learning and all the development we have. Actually, in the second part of the project, we've been working a lot on improvements on the bot. We had a small team dedicated to the improvements, so actually every day we were looking at what kind of question they were putting to Mario and how Mario was responding. Actually, myself, I was curious every night looking at the question. And this way, every day we were able to increase the answers, increase the topics, and this is the result. From the first day to the last days, the improvement in answers was plus 300%. We have 5 times the topics recognized. So the bot was really growing day by day. We had, in a few months, 526 updates. The update is very easy, it's just uploading a file is not at all a problem, but this was happening 3, 4, 5 times a day. Then communication, this was key, because the success of the project was about the adoption. So we have found, we needed many users, not just to create a success use case, but because we wanted really to test how the bot was performing using machine learning. So we decided to go for direct mailing. We had a first mail directed to all the employees of the banks with a nice graphic, with a like, kind of conversational interface. And the point was being very specific and clear about the scope of the bot and the way to interact with bot. This was very important. We also put a small video, 90-minute video, very engaging with music, very quick, where users can really quickly understand what it was about, how to interact with the bot, what was the actual topic of the bot, the scope of the bot. And this was happening like 50, 60 days before the weekend of the migration, when actually the bot was available. Then we sent a second mail 10 days before the migration to kind of recall of Mario for the users and communicating that the bot actually has increased its capability, because actually in 40 days it was really upgraded in its contents. Okay, the result was we had a very very big engagement. Out of 4,000 employees of the bank, we had 70% of the users visited the bot. That means that they clicked on the icon, they read the first message that Mario was giving out, and 40% actually interacted with the bot. And many users, like 45%, were going back to Mario and asking questions. And this is very high if we think that Mario was just a support bot. So if everything was clear for you, you didn't need any support, there was no point in using the bot. So actually, some of these people were going to the bot just on curiosity, so they were just asking questions just to see how it was working. These are two examples of interaction. I leave you the reading. The first one is a case of disambiguation. So when the question was not clear, the bot was actually putting another question to understand the real point. And the second one is just a normal conversation. This is about a Sunday morning. This is a real conversation. For two times, the employee of the branches were called in the branch for the whole Sunday morning for doing tests. So they were doing tests, and at the end of the test, they were asked to stay in the branch waiting for a message. So everybody was finishing like 11 o'clock. Everybody wanted to go home, and they were calling the help desk or asking Mario, can we go home? And he was saying, no, you need to wait for a message.
Okay. In terms of platform, we have employees can talk with Mario using two channels. Skype for Business, internal Skype for Business, so they find him in the contact list, like just like any other colleague. Or they can talk with him through a dedicated web chat HTML page. And once Mario receives the input from the user, first thing there is a natural language understanding. Then there is a custom dialogue manager written in code. And then there is also an administrative interface in which business people can look at the ongoing conversations and also update in real time the contents. And very important, there are also regression tests. So as Mario grew, we added more and more tests, and now there are more than 1,000 regression tests. It means that every time you do a new training of machine learning or you change something, there are more than 1,000 different user inputs that are tried in automatically, and you see if bot behavior is still as you want it or it's changing. So you guarantee that behaves well. But why did we say smart? For us, meaning that a bot is smart is that it never says, I didn't understand. And you can do this leveraging artificial intelligence. There are many problems. We just show you a few with the solutions. So, first problem is that the same question can be answered in many different ways, but for this there is our proprietary technology on natural language understanding and machine learning. Then there may be misspellings and things called in different ways. We found a way to manage autocorrect, which is very tricky in chatbot, but it works well, and also to manage aliases. So if things are said in different ways, still the dialogue manager can give the good response. Then also, often questions can be very complicated too, much complicated. Sometimes users don't write like in a chat, but they write very long paragraphs, like if it was an email. And technology cannot understand such a long text, but what we did, since we can have a very good understanding from we use the partial understanding to provide the information on the user, to the users. I didn't understand what you're asking, but I understood you're talking about this. So please ask me in a different way, and by the way, about this, you can ask me this, this, and this. So the users, just through the conversation, would found what they were looking for and also understand how to ask questions to the bot. And also, out of scope, users often ask about things that were out of the bot scope. And what we did is we introduced explicit out of scope. So if a user asks something that the bot doesn't know, it tells, look, about this topic, I don't know anything. So the user doesn't try to rephrase and ask the same thing in different ways. And also, this is good for them because they know what they can do and can't do with the bot.
Okay, lesson learned. We had many lessons learned to share with you. The first one is that employees loved Mario. Actually, they were, at the end of the project, he became kind of a character. That's why we've done this 3D print. Mm-hmm. But apart from that, actually, people like to engage with the bot. We had a very high adoption because people really liked it and went back to the bot. And this is probably the most important. Make users really aware, really clear what is the scope of the bot and how to interact with it. Because if the question is in scope and the question is written like in a chat way, not in an email way, no matter what, the bot is answering. It's answering or is getting you into the answer. So this is really important. The intelligent bot is a key for a good user experience, as Alessandro said. I mean, the key was keeping up the conversation, keeping on, never say, I don't understand. So even if the question was bad, Mario was answering to just get the user to the point, to the right question, and actually the user were learning. After a few exchange, after a few conversations, we could see in many cases that the user understood how to interact, so with the short sentences, of course. Okay, this is another thing that surprised me. Actually, Alessandro was very confident on the result at the beginning. He said, no, it's going to be very smart. I said, okay, I want to see the result. At the end, really, the result was really over my expectation. We had many cases of really nice exchanges. The understanding was very good. It was really, really working beyond my expectation. Okay, this is another point. I mean, it's about at least Mario liked to stay in his comfort zone, so to just stay on the narrow knowledge base. As the weeks went by, we started to grow the knowledge base, to increase the question, the entity, the intent, and this, in some cases, could make some confusion. So the same question for 2 months was answered correctly. After an update, the same question, Mario was giving the wrong answer. This is not very nice for who's driving the bot. So the solution was the non-regression test, and this was working very good. So actually, we could increase like 3 times the knowledge base. But this is key for the next project we are working on, which is just to use it on an even broader scale. At the end, you need a team behind. Don't imagine a team of 10 data scientists. We were just like 3 people, not working full time. So at the end, it was like almost 1 full-time equivalent working on a daily basis on the bot. But the key is following the bot, looking at the behavior, because it's a very, very powerful tool and you cannot leave it alone. So, but really, it's not that much effort. It's like one person or a team of 2 or 3 just overlooking the bot was enough, at least for the 3 months where the bot was actually growing. And the last lesson learned is that 50% of the project was before going live and 50% was after that, because the fine-tuning of the bot was really the best part of the project.
Now, looking ahead, what we're doing, we are sharing the experience. So we had an article on Corriere della Sera a couple of weeks ago. We also had a long meeting talking about Mario inside the Italian Banking Association to share it with other banks. And UBI is extending Mario Bot support daily customer support. And conversely, we are building a new platform support even larger chatbots in production. And then Mario asked us to tell you grazie.
Una domanda in italiano?
Io.
Siete stati troppo veloci, non so chi ha alzato per primo. Chi è che ha detto io?
Io.
Questa domanda a lui, le altre dopo, durante...
Posso fare un bonifico bancario con questo?
Questo è un bot, non è commerciale.
Posso fare solo delle... posso chiedere solo informazioni?
I colleghi della banca, quindi i dipendenti della banca, possono utilizzare il bot per chiedere informazioni, dubbi, gestire anomalie, cosa che oggi viene svolta da...
Quindi è interno.
Noi abbiamo del desk interno con dove lavorano 100 persone per rispondere alle domande dei nostri dipendenti. Abbiamo un progetto in corso anche per sviluppare uno esposto all'esterno, quindi sull'app, piuttosto che sul sito internet, ma già stiamo lavorando.
Ci sono, e questa è stata brevissima, una delle altre due. È stato più visto più veloce di
una cosa, forse mi sono perso un pezzo, ma nello screenshot il bot parlava in inglese.
No, l'avevo tradotto.
Ah, ok, no. Per la presentazione.
Italiano.
Avete dato la possibilità di usare Skype, che ha tutta una serie di funzionalità intrinseche, dalla gestione dello stato, il passare in conference, poter passare in voce, poter mettere delle immagini, uno screenshot. Sono al problema il fatto che se uno per un po' di tempo non interagisce va in uno stato di offline. Tutto questo non vi ha creato problemi o è stato indifferente rispetto alla logica intrinseca del bot che gestisce un dialogo ma in modo più specifico rispetto, cioè un tool che nasce per gestire un'interazione con l'uomo. È una buona interfaccia per gestire la comunicazione con un chatbot che avrà componenti natural language interface, ma comunque è diverso.
Allora, innanzitutto Skype for Business non ha tante funzionalità, ad esempio le immagini non si possono mandare su Skype for Business, quindi qui abbiamo sia le immagini.
Sì, sì, allegate, sì.
Puoi mandarle il bot.
No, su questo abbiamo usato, diciamo, un workaround, quindi le mandavamo dei link, quindi come risposta a volte Mario dava un'immagine, un video, una normativa, un documento. No, in realtà abbiamo gestito, non ci ha creato problemi, anche se in alcuni casi le domande un po' più lunghe non si prestano molto al, diciamo, al device. Ma anche qui, diciamo, in molti casi abbiamo utilizzato, in caso in cui la risposta fosse veramente complessa, quindi necessitasse di una pagina o due, preferivamo mandare i documenti preconfezionati, quindi magari una risposta complessa veniva gestita attraverso l'invio di una slide PowerPoint ben fatta. Quindi in realtà anche se bisogna dire che gli utenti, la maggior parte utilizzava la chat, perché noi Skype for Business lo abilitiamo con motivi di sicurezza solo per chi ha il telefono aziendale, perché il telefono aziendale, diciamo, ha tutto un sistema di sicurezza, per cui è difficile che capiscano le credenziali, cosa che bisogna mettere in Skype for Business. Quindi la maggior parte degli utenti utilizzavano l'interfaccia chat all'interno della nostra intranet.
Mi hanno chiesto di rispondere anche alla quarta domanda.
Grazie. Posso sapere i criteri in base al quale Ubi poi ha scelto Conversate per come vendor?
La scelta è stata in tutto su come primo progetto non volevamo impegnarci dal punto di vista di investimento di tempo ed economico con un fornitore invasivo, il nome potrebbe essere IBM Watson, l'abbiamo interpellato anche Watson, cioè abbiamo visti tutti, tra cui Watson. Sono delle soluzioni molto invasive per cui alla fine i tempi non sarebbero stati possibili. E secondo, essendo inizialmente una sperimentazione che poi invece la fase fine sta proseguendo, non volevamo come primo tentativo portarci a casa un vendor troppo invasivo. Sicuramente è stato anche determinante la flessibilità che può dare una startup. Infatti questo io l'ho spesso come un ottimo esempio di collaborazione e di contaminazione tra una grande banca e una startup. Effettivamente siamo riusciti in poco tempo a avere un risultato eccezionale, cosa che sicuramente non avremmo potuto gestire con un altro, con un fornitore istituzionale.
Grazie.